So I'm Fê Cortez, I come from Brazil, and I created this movement called Menos do Lixo, that's one less trash, in order to empower people to see that their daily habits, their daily steps and actions, they matter. We are 7 billion people now in the world, and we are using too much plastic, too much disposable plastic, and that creates a problem that if we don't change our habits, by 2050, we're gonna have more plastic than fish on the oceans. So it all began to me when I watched Trash, a movie by Jeremy Irons, where he goes to different places on Earth, and one of those places is the Pacific Gyre, where we have an amount of plastic, like a plastic soup, 17 times the size of Portugal. And it really occurred to me that this trash, that this situation, is because of what I was doing, of what we are doing as society. So on 2012, when I watched this movie, I felt very uncomfortable about it, so I decided to change my actions. And I bought a retractable cup. This cup has been walking with me, and I developed a new one after that, but then I bought 20 cups and I gave to my friends those cups. And I realized that whenever they use their cups, they just gain conscience about the waste they were generating, the trash that we generate every day. So using the cup reminded us that we can have another option. And so that's why I launched Menos um Lixo, as first as this personal blog that I would tell people what were the options they had and the power they have in their hands, saying no to something and saying yes to something. I wanted to make sustainability and conscious consumption something very easy, because from 2012 when I watched the movie to 2015, I studied a lot. I watched lots of films and documentaries and I studied a lot. And what I realized is that the language used to communicate environmental issues and sustainability is very tough. It's very hard and it's very scientific. So when you mean climate change, what people understand about climate change? They don't know what this means. They don't know what carbon footprint is. They don't know mainly the terms we're using. So I realized that we were speaking to a few people and we had to speak to the mass, to everyone, because it's everyone's problem and it's everyone's solution. So Menos um Lixo exists to make this transformation, to make this change your behavior possible and easy and sexy and cool. That's another thing. I come from fashion industry. So for me, things had to be beautiful and cool and nice and sexy. People, unfortunately, they don't connect with the hippie lifestyle and the hippie look and feel, you know? But besides that, there's this really urgent need for us to change the way we live and to change the values that drive our society. Because those values didn't drive us to an equal society or to a sustainable society. And so now we have to rethink what we've done so far and to act as fast as we can, as effective as we can to change this. So what drove me was the plastic problem, the disposable problem, and I think this connects to the way we live our lives as human beings today on Earth. We as planet were very inspired by the US way of living, way of being. And if everybody on Earth would live like the US, they say we would need something around 9 to 13 planets. We only have one. So there's something wrong. Success cannot be the only thing we pursued in our lives, and money cannot be the only thing we aim to get, because we are constantly disposing of everything. We're disposing of plastic cups, of straws, of, you know, clutterly, of lots of things, but then we're disposing of our true moments, we're disposing of people, we're disposing of what really matters. We are not happier by doing that. And on the contrary, we now have the highest rates of depression, and the health organization says that depression is going to be the thing that takes us more, the main cause that takes us out of work. So it's a very weird paradox that we are giving our lives to money, as we choose to work on things we don't like, to make money, to buy things we don't need, and then we are depressed. And then we are turning our planet into this huge trash can, because we think that we need those things that we need to sell our energy and our lives to something, you know, we don't need. So it's like we have to step back and rethink everything and say, does this make sense? Because in my opinion, it doesn't make sense, you know. It doesn't make sense to continue living the way we do, and to we didn't reach a better quality of life for the most part of humanity. We're still facing poverty, we're still facing droughts, we're still facing people dying because they don't have food and dying because they don't have water. And we are in 2018. It's not acceptable anymore. What we do in Brazil is we try to get people to act. This is the small thing that they can do, is to use the cup, but they can use whatever cup they like. And we now get them to participate on cleanups, on beach cleanups. I was nominee ambassador for the Clean Seas campaign, the UN Clean Seas campaign, and we do some things in Brazil. And we could pass a law now to ban straws, to ban plastic straws, that are very small, but are a very harmful item that reaches the oceans every day and kills lots of mammals and lots of fish and everything. So we are starting to see people engaged in our campaign, changing their daily habits. Not only the cups, but moon cups and straws and all the disposables, plastic bags that we are used to deal with on our daily lives. We have more than 200,000 followers on Instagram so far, and it's our main channel to communicate to people. We have a YouTube channel as well, where we create some web series and everything regarding the sustainability and conscious consumption. And what I see is that people are beginning to be aware of their power as consumers. We talk a lot about our powers as individuals to change society through our choices, our daily life choices. And so they are starting to take actions. The banning of the straws was something we could get because we could get people to sign a petition to deliver to our mayor and say, hey, we need this. This is something important for us. And now more than 30 cities in Rio, in Brazil, joined us and passed the same law. So I think it's something very, very contagious. Whenever people realize their power, the power they have to change the daily things and the major, the big things that once they thought only governments and industries were able to change, then I see things, you know, happening faster than 2 years ago. So it's very nice to see people take action on those small steps. And those small steps, they are the start of a long journey that we see happening right now. We could see it as a very hard time ahead or as an opportunity. We in Brazil have a very powerful Congress of agribusiness that was co-responsible for electing our president. We in Brazil use more pesticides than every other country in the world per person. We in Brazil, on the other hand, have lots of very fertile soil and we could plant lots of things. And we export those things. We export soy and corn and, you know, cattle. Our main market is not inside. So, and also the agribusiness is responsible for deforestation in Amazon forest and for 70% of our green gas emissions. And they are very powerful because they have money. What I see now is that it's a unique opportunity for us, NGOs, civil society, to get united in a way we never did. Because we're facing a challenge that we've never seen before. Our elected president, he threatened to extinguish the environment ministry and to put it together with agricultural ministry. So it's like getting the sheep together with the wolves. And it's not gonna be good for anyone, because what I think that we don't see is a long-term vision. If we deforest the Amazon forest, and we don't need to do that because we still have lots of places where we can grow crops in Brazil, we are huge land with lots of lands that are not being used, we're not gonna have rain. And rain now is free because it's not generated by any human power or money, and it won't be. So we have this rain machine that's the biggest rain machine on Earth that enables agricultural to happen in Brazil, and so that the things grow there. And if we deforest Amazon and other forests like Cerrado and other biodiversity regions we have there, we're not gonna have our main subsistence, that is the food. And we're not gonna export, we're not gonna make that money. So I think that we have to face it in a long term. And I think that now, I cannot tell you how it's gonna be because everything is so gray. It's not black, it's not white, it's gray. But what I see is that we have to get together as civil society and as NGOs and as activists to tell what we want and to work together with this government so that the government sees the opportunities we have. We're facing this moment now where plastic is being attacked in the world, where disposables are being attacked in the world. And the alternative to that is nature, is natural materials like cornstarch and like other things that we have in abundance in Brazil. So we could use our nature capital to and all our resources to create a new economy. We could rule the world on that. We could, you know, not rule because we're bigger, but we could give a direction with alternatives. We're very creative people there. So if we invest in the right thing, then we can create a new model and help other countries to solve their problems as well as solving our problems. So maybe our government was going to be smart enough to understand and to see all the opportunities we have, the money opportunities we have, the financial opportunities we have, because that's what they talk about. They only talk about money. There's no human rights, there's no land rights, there's no indigenous rights, it's money. And it can be very profitable if you look at land not as resources, but as a partnership so that humans and nature can evolve and cooperate to live in a better better world for everyone. I think that there's one thing that I reflected a lot yesterday is that sometimes we only hear the trees falling on a forest. We don't hear all the millions of trees that are, you know, growing and that are small. And when you look at a conference like that with so many young people connected to environmental issues and doing things in different countries and different issues of land use, and we see that there's lots going on. There's a lot of innovation coming. There's a lot of alternatives coming, and things are being done. So sometimes we only hear the big trees falling because they are louder and they are older. So I think you have to start looking at the new trees that are, you know, rising and that are growing right now, because that's where our future is. And I'm very hopeful for our future because I think that lots of people are working on it. And maybe the money is not still on those hands, but it will be. As a matter of fact, it cannot be other way around. Otherwise, there's not going to be any hands for us to put any money on because there's not going to be life, our life here. So I learned a lot about this, the landscapes used, because this is not my mainly learning, my main knowledge. And I was very happy to see everything that's going on and to see that young people are connected to that and wanting to make a difference and already making a difference. So it was a pleasure to share the panel with three other women, and that means a lot in a world that's ruled by men. So we're all women talking about things that we are already doing, things that are happening, not projects that we are imagining, but people that are able to make it happen. And I think that youth have this power. They have the energy to make things happen. And we all have like social media now, so we can connect, and technology. We can connect in a brighter way, in a wider way, and in a more intelligent way, so that we can share knowledge and help each other towards the future we want to see and we want to make happen.